Good morning. And welcome to our worship service this morning. Today, traditionally, is known as Good Shepherd Sunday, and that is because of the gospel we will be reading. Also, this being a non-communion Sunday, you will need your red worship book for the entire service. So, at this time, I ask that you turn to page 94 in the front of the worship book, and invite those who can do so without difficulty to please stand as we prepare our hearts and minds for worship with the order of confession and forgiveness. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin, and made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. We now begin our worship by singing hymn number 502, The King of Love, My Shepherd Is, in the back of your worship. Hymn number 502, The King of Love, My Shepherd Is.
Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is April 22nd, 2018. This is the fourth Sunday of Easter. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508.
Thank you.
Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders, among mortals by which we must be saved. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Becky Chandler Troth will do the song.
Items for the garage sale. If you had some
up all the church and arrangements will be made for it to be picked up in the church. Also, May 20th is Pentecost, the birthday of the church. And that is, of course, one of our three red Sundays of the year. Passion Sunday being the first, then Pentecost, and then, of course, in the fall, Reformation Sunday. So, May 20th is Red Sunday. So, wear something red in honor of the birthday of the church. And the last announcement I have is somewhat of a peculiar one or strange one. But if someone happens to call you at night or during the day and say that I told them to call you because they need money and that you would give them money, immediately hang up. We had one of our street people who've been around for the past 18 years come in and take a directory that was either outside my office or in the atrium, and they had the nerve to call me the other night. And so they have all their phone numbers. So I have no idea. I don't think they would do that, but if by chance they would, no, immediately hang up, don't even talk with them. Because obviously I would not tell them to call you because they need money. So that's unfortunately one of the things of having directories out for people to pick up is being on hand to people. So just to give you that warning. But as I say, the chances are very low that they will have. Let us now listen to the call. can't share this with you. Amen. Joel, our middle son, was a little bit older, had to be older than Jamie today because he could walk. He got loose from Gina during a Wednesday night midweek service. Came running up the aisle, and so I picked him up and held him. Preached the whole sermon, holding Joel, and did the whole rest of the sermon. Because he wouldn't go back to his mother, and he was determined to stay with me. So Jamie knew how to stay in his home for his son. I know the fit. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Today, as I mentioned, is traditionally known as Good Shepherd Sunday, and it has to do with our gospel lesson for today, where Jesus says he is the Good Shepherd. But instead of focusing on that, which all of us are fully aware that Jesus is our shepherd, that he is the one who walks with us through the valley of the shadow of death, that he is the one who lays down his life for our salvation, that he is the one who through his resurrection overcame sin, death, and the devil for us so that we might be his own and live under him in his kingdom. So today, I want us to go back to our first lesson. Now, you may wonder why I want to turn to the testimony of Peter and John before the Sanhedrin. But the reason is because from this, we receive a very important lesson for the modern day church. Because the modern day church finds itself in situations similar to the early church of Peter and John. Our reading today comes from the fourth chapter of Acts, which is a continuation of a situation that actually starts in the third chapter of Acts. And what that is that Peter and John were going up to the temple to pray. It was the ninth hour. It was one of the regulated prayer hours of the Jewish people. And before they arrived to the temple gate, a lame man had been brought up and had been put at the gate in order to ask for alms. So Peter and John approach this man, and they stare at him intently, and he thinks they're going to offer him alms, so he asks him for some. And Peter replies with these words, "I have no silver and gold, but what I do have, I give to you in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Rise up and walk." And he took him by the right hand and raised him up, and immediately his feet and ankles were made strong. And leaping up, he stood and began to walk and entered the temple with him, walking and leaping and praising God. So Peter and John have healed this lame man. And, of course, this creates quite a stir, just like when we read the gospel lessons of Jesus healing at the temple. It always calls a commotion, a crowd gathering. And Peter uses this as an opportunity to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ. Of course, word gets back to the high priest and the other priests, the members of the Sanhedrin, and they are furious. And so they have Peter and John arrested. Where we pick up the story in our first lesson for today, John and Peter have been put in prison, and now it's the next day, and they have been brought in front of the Sanhedrin for trial. And as they stand before the high priest, he asks them a very simple question. And when you first hear the question, you may think, well, what's so bad about that question? I mean, a miracle has happened. Wouldn't people want to know how it came about? And so, as we read in the fourth chapter, the seventh verse, and when they had set them in the midst, that is, Peter and John, in the midst of the priest and the Sanhedrin, they inquired, "By what power or by what name did you do this?" As I said, that question seems simple. There doesn't seem anything threatening about that question when you look on it at the surface. It doesn't seem to have any ulterior motive to it. That's because we're reading in English. Translation. The question was full of alternate reasons for being asked. It was not being asked because Caiaphas and Annas and the rest really wanted to know how this happened. They knew was done in the name of Jesus. They asked this question, by what power, by what name did you do this? This is a question of intimidation. They are trying to intimidate Peter and John so they will be quiet and that they will no longer proclaim the good news of Jesus. They think by asking this question, Peter and John will think about what happened to Jesus, how he was crucified as an enemy of the Roman Empire, and that those memories would give them such a chill that they would be intimidated to keep quiet. But what Annas and Caiaphas and the rest didn't realize was they weren't dealing with a Peter of Passion or Holy Week. They weren't dealing with a Peter who denied Jesus three times before they caught a crow. They were dealing with a Peter of the resurrected Lord Jesus Christ. They were dealing with a Peter who Jesus had taken aside when he fed them at the lake and asked him, Peter, do you love me? Feed my sheep. This was now the Peter and John, emboldened by the resurrected Christ, emboldened by the power of the name of Jesus. And when it comes to the church today, we need to remember to call upon the power in the name of Jesus Christ. When we are witnessing, when we are confronted, when society tries to intimidate us, we need to remember to call upon the name of Jesus. By what name, by what power do you do this? Today's society asks the same question. We all know that when this country was founded, that when we won our independence from Great Britain, became the United States of America with the signing of adoption of the Constitution, that the majority of Europeans, if not all of the Europeans, settled here at that time were the Judeo-Christian heritage. They were the Judeo-Christian heritage and the heritage of the Native Americans. Some who had become Christian already. But at that time, of course, the United States was only 13 states. So we hadn't expanded. But that was the foundation of our country. And so Judeo-Christian values ruled this nation up until the 20th century. And the latter part of the 20th century. After World War II, we began to be flooded with more and more immigrants that were not from the European countries from which the immigration had mostly come during the 18th and 19th century. We began to have immigrants that were Buddhist and Muslim and Shinto and Taoist and Sikh and Hindu and all these other religions of the world. And so society started heading into a world, pluralistic society. Now we're not all European heritage, we're not all Judeo-Christian heritage. So who are you to stand up and say, you are the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through you? Who are you in the midst of all these other religions, even though the Christian faith is still a majority of this nation? Who are you to say that Jesus is the only way to heaven? It's the same question that Caiaphas and Annas asked back in 30-something AD, the Peter and John. And the answer is the same. The power of the name of Jesus Christ. Nothing has changed as far as the responsibility of the church. But society continues to try to intimidate us, to tell us to be quiet, to tell us to keep our faith within the four walls of our worship space, to not witness to society. So what happened with Peter and John? What did they say? Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to the rulers of the people and elders, if we are being examined today concerning a good deed done to a crippled man, by what means since this man has been healed, let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ, crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by him this man is standing before me. By the name of Jesus Christ. That was the answer then, and that is the answer now. That phrase, name of Jesus Christ, means by the authority of or the power of Jesus Christ. That power and authority doesn't come from us. It doesn't come from our congregation. It doesn't come from our denomination. The authority and the power comes from the name of Jesus Christ, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And when you examine the religion in the world, no other religion has a person making that claim. Buddha doesn't say go out and do things in the name of Buddha. Confucius didn't say go out and do things in the name of Confucius. Moses didn't say go out and do things in the name of Moses. And Muhammad didn't say go out and do things in the name of Muhammad. Only Jesus Christ says that there is power in his name to do things that people will be amazed. Only the power of Jesus can propel the church in its witnessing and sustain it in its persecution. The name of Jesus. And that is a power that we have, I think, in many areas forgotten. That we forget how much power is in the name. Society continues to try to intimidate us, and too often we back off. We become quiet. Or we try to curry society's favor by being involved in areas that are not areas of the church. And takes us away from the number one purpose of the church, which is to save souls. Jesus Christ came to save sin. We hear that over and over and over again throughout the pages of the New Testament. Jesus did not come to set up a political party. He did not come to say one political agenda was more favored than another. In fact, when they tried to involve him in politics, what did Jesus say? He said, render unto Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's. When Peter and Paul were asked that same question, they said, God has given to the state the power of the sword. That is the power to rule, to keep order in society. And he has given the power of salvation into Jesus Christ. That is our mission. To preach the good news that Jesus saves. No matter who you are, no matter how you are, no matter where you're from, Jesus saves sinners. But the church continues to be intimidated, and too often the church remains quiet. We know that in the Middle East and in other places, Christian men, women, and children are slaughtered simply because they are Christian. And we see few politicians or media outlets even taking notice. We know that in our own society, the church is often attacked in the media, in TV, in radio, and in the movies. Even though Christian-based movies oftentimes are the most successful movies of the year, more times been making movies and TV sitcoms and more, which ridicule the church and those who are followers of Jesus Christ. Crucifixes, rosaries, pictures of Jesus, statues of the apostles have been desecrated more than any other type of religious symbol. Things have been done to the crucifix and to the pictures of statues of the Virgin Mary or the apostles that are too disgusting to even mention here. But you don't see it being done to the statue of Buddha. You don't see it being done to the Star of the Crescent, the symbol of Islam. You don't see it being done to the Hebrew god Isha, but Christianity constantly is being, our most sacred symbols are being desecrated by artists under the protection of freedom of speech. She really had a wonderful family father that's meant for that to cover art in such a despicable way. Some of you, I'm sure, saw the article about the football coach who was fired simply for kneeling on the field after a game and offering a prayer. Silent. So, we were up in Griffith. The head football coach at Griffith High School was a member of the church. Being a young church, I had time to help him coach. And he said a prayer before after every ball game. No one ever complained. There was a teacher who was fired simply because they gave a student a Bible because the student had asked the teacher for one. It wasn't a situation where the teacher was trying to evangelize the child, and the child had come to her with problems, and she said, here, you need to read this. The child had asked the teacher to give her a copy of the Bible, and she was fired. A young Marine was cursed and ridiculed because she had Bible verses on her computer, and eventually was court-martialed. Persecution still went on. Maybe now, in sly ways, as much as in the days of Rome. Some of you may have seen the article of Kent State this weekend. Some professor was having some kind of symposium on Christianity, a white man's religion, making the assumption that Christianity is only for us white people, and we use it to dominate everybody else. Tell that to 1,000 Africans a day who are becoming Christian. Tell that to 1,000 Asians a day who are becoming Christian. Tell that to 100 Muslims a day who are becoming Christian in Germany. Tell that to all Central South America who are Christian. It's the white man's religion. Our taxes paid for Kent State. What kind of professor do they hire that would attack a faith that has done more than any other faith in the world to relieve the suffering of people who are hungry and oppressed and the victims of floods and tsunamis and earthquakes and all these other things? So how do we overcome this intimidation? What do we do? Do we just stay within the walls of our church? Or do we be like Peter and John? In the 12th verse we read, Peter is still speaking. He says, and this is something you should underline if you have your own Bible. If you don't, you should underline it in your inserts and pay home and underline it in your Bible or highlight it. And there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. That didn't mean clearer than that. No other name under heaven by which people might be saved except the name of Jesus Christ. The word salvation means to be, to have deliverance. Deliverance from sin, death, and the power of the devil. The word means preservation, to be preserved in faith by the Holy Spirit and our faith in Jesus Christ, so that we have that place in heaven. It means a oneness with God through our faith in Jesus Christ. It means a free gift of deliverance from sin. Muhammad doesn't promise that. Moses doesn't promise that. Buddhism confuses every misguessed it. Only Jesus tells us that faith in him we receive a free gift of deliverance from sin. And atheists can say all they want about they don't believe in God, and so on and so forth, but every person wonders about what happened in front dead in this life. I don't care who you are. You can be as intellectual and intelligent as can be and think you don't believe in God, but when it comes to your own death, you're going to wonder what lies beyond. Peter tells us that in Jesus Christ we have that free gift of deliverance. We don't have to go to Mecca and Medina. We don't have to go to Jerusalem. We don't have to go to some monastery in the Himalayas. We don't have to go to some sacred place in Japan, some Shinto shrine. All we have to do is believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. And we have that free gift of deliverance. The word also means to be safe or to be protected. Safe and protected from eternal damnation. Safe and protected. So that when we leave this earth, we enter into that glorious kingdom of heaven, to that mansion prepared for us by Jesus Christ himself, in that kingdom where there is no more death, no more grief, nor crying or pain. For the old order of things have passed away. The word, when he says, there's no other men under heaven given among men, that word given means to bestow something on someone. It means to commit something to someone. It is to bring forth something. So salvation is bestowed upon us, committed to us, held forth to us through faith in Jesus Christ. And the word saved means to deliver from danger. Jesus Christ delivers us from sin, death, and life. That is why he is our good shepherd. That is why he is the one who walks with us in the valley of the shadow of death. He is the one who sets that table before us in the presence of our enemies, and anoints our head with oil, and makes our cup overflow. Because he's the only name. There is power in the name of Jesus, and the church today needs to recapture the power of the name of Jesus. Stop trying to figure everything out themselves. The worst thing that has happened with the latter 20th century church and the early 21st century church, or one of the worst things, is we trying to come up with solutions for witnessing on our own instead of relying on the power of the name of Jesus. Instead of trying to change beliefs, or trying to rewrite the commandments, or trying to make other excuses, we need to rely on the power of the name of Jesus Christ. That's all Peter and John did. They relied on that, and they eventually are free. And so we today, in a society that is hostile to our faith, in a world that is hostile to our beliefs, we need to rely on the power of the name of Jesus Christ. Because the resurrected Lord has the power over all things. And by using that power, the church will continue to prevail as it has done for centuries. Against its enemies and those who would destroy us. So grab hold of the power in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Let us now sing Soon and Very Soon in number 439 in the back of your worship. In number 430.
Thank you. The joy will be under his watchful eye.
Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the lonely, the afflicted, those in prison, those persecuted for the faith, and all the sick, that the Holy Spirit would comfort them and grant them strength and healing. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who pass through the valley of the shadow of death, that in the companionship of their great good shepherd and in the confidence of his victory over death and the grave, they may fear no evil. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the faithful who have gone before us and who dwell in the house of the Lord forevermore, let us give thanks and praise, asking that we together with them may look forward to the joy of our resurrection. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
And your hand, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, for your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Gathered in one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
May the Almighty and merciful God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, keep you in his light and truth and love, now and forever.
Amen.
We conclude our worship with Christ is Alive, Let Christians Sing, hymn number 389 in the ninth of your worship. Hymn number 389, Christ is Alive, Let Us Christians Sing.
Thank you.
Thank you for watching today's service. This is April 24th, 2018, the fourth Sunday of Easter, Good Shepherd Sunday. Flowers on the chancel stand were given by Mike Cochran in honor of Debbie Cochran's birthday and by Linda Fox to the glory of God. Our pastor is the Reverend John H. Pollock. Our choir director is Vicki Perks, and our organist is Greg Nolte.